Good morning, guys. So today we're going to talk about how you get new species, like two species evolving from one ancestral species. This is your notes, so you need to, if you have your science notebook at home, take out your science notebook and write this down as a title. If you don't have your science notebook, just start a new page of paper and you're going to be writing down some of the notes in there. You'll ultimately use this stuff next week when we end up having our evolution unit test. And yes, you get to use all of these notes on the test. So how easy can that be? Pretty exciting. Okay, so let's go. So when we say this question, I wrote it slightly differently, but how does natural selection generate new species? Now, what I mean by that is not the way we normally see natural selection. Let's explain this little picture here. Say I have some ancestral species in the past. I'm going to call it species A. And this is a long time ago. And then this is today. So this is the past. This is today. Well, we would think of natural selection as working as, favoring certain traits over time. Those traits become more common, more developed over time. And you slowly change species A into species B. That is a new species. Species B is a new species from this one A here. But it never creates a higher number of species or more species. What today is about is how does natural selection do this? So how do you take one species from the past and evolve it into two different species or more? Now let me pause for a second and say you should be writing this down in your notes. This is how natural selection works, just to change one species into a new species. This diagram here represents how natural selection might change one ancestral species into more species. More species. Pause this video so you can get this idea down in this little branch down in your notes. So another way of looking at this, again, this is the past. This ancestral species, through natural selection, a whole bunch of small changes, suddenly started making species C and species B. To kind of give you a real example of what we're talking about here, look at these different species of elephants, right? They all came from some ancestral species of elephant. And here you have the branching of the trees that I have drawn here. How does natural selection ever get two species out of one ancestor? In this case, it got five African species of elephants that came from one common ancestor. So how does a branching point work? How do you get new species is what we're after today. Okay, so in order to that, since I keep saying this word species, we really should write down and write this down. What is exactly a species? Okay, what it means. So species are organisms that look alike and can reproduce with each other. That's the scientific definition. So these two panda bears look alike, and assuming they're male and female, they can reproduce with each other. So they're the same species. These two parrots are the same species. They look alike and can reproduce with each other. Not the same species, right? Bird, mouse don't look alike, and yeah, they can't reproduce with each other. But all the breeds of dogs, notice the word I just used there. I used breed and not species of dogs. All the breeds of dogs, even, technically these guys probably can't reproduce with each other, but dogs in general can reproduce with each other. So dogs are all considered the same species. Now, you might say, well, this is never going to happen, right? They can't really reproduce. And yeah, you're probably right. And the word species, humans made up, it doesn't fit every case. But technically, we consider these guys the same species, even though this guy's the Great Danes are so big. There's also other gray areas of the word species. Some of you guys know what a mule is, or at least you've heard of a mule. A horse, which is one species, and a donkey, which is another species, they can actually reproduce. So it's breaking this rule that I just told you, because when a horse and a donkey reproduce, they make a mule. So it makes a whole nother kind of horse, if you will. And it turns out that mules are sterile, meaning there's never been a mule that's had a baby with another mule. Because what happens, these two guys are different enough in their DNA that when they reproduce, they're similar enough that they can reproduce and make a baby that can survive. But they're different enough that when they reproduce, the baby they make, its DNA and its sex cells is so confused it can't reproduce and have a baby. So the donkey and the horse are considered two different species, and the mule is considered a hybrid. So the word species in general works, but there's exceptions, just like the dogs were the species Words kind of breaks down a little bit, and in this case here, it kind of breaks down a little bit. But for the fruit flies that I used to study, here's a list. Even though you might think they all look like fruit flies, but these are all different species of fruit flies. They don't look exactly similar, but if you put them in the same environment, they can't reproduce with each other. So they've evolved to be different species over time. And again, looking at the question of today, how did you get these multiple species of fruit flies from some ancestor in the past? There's just a couple at this point. Now, to get to that answer, what I want you to do is you're going to pause this video here in just a second. The next link on the Schoology work for this week has this Yale Peabody Museum video link. And what it does, it first, like the 2 or 3 minutes, kind of gives you just some general background on evolution. But then the last about 2 minutes or so, it actually gives you the answer to this question. How do you get a branch in a family tree? How does two species evolve from one? And they started answering the question when they start showing you the cartoon bunnies. So when you see the cartoon bunnies, what I want you to do is take notes on the video's explanation of the answer to this question. Okay, and then we'll come back and talk about what you've done. So pause this PowerPoint right now, this PowerPoint video right now, and come back to it in just a minute after you've watched this Yale Peabody video. Pause it. Pause it. Okay. So you should have gotten from that video that the basic answer is this fancy term, geographic isolation. Geographic has to do with something on the earth, geography, and isolation is by themselves. So what the video basically said is a population has to get isolated by itself. So in the bunny's case, it was a volcano and it was a river that split the population into two. So here's kind of an example of that. So say I have some ancestral in the past species of bugs, and this is supposed to be a river. A river comes and splits those two species in two. Well, what's going to happen is, they're going to be living their lives on either side of the river, and let's say the river is wide enough that they can't swim across or fly across normally. And so what's going to happen is some random mutations will happen in this population. Notice the green one popped up over here. And natural selection is going to favor certain things over here. Maybe green is good. And over here, different random mutations will happen, and maybe these guys are better adapted at dry conditions or something like that. Natural selection might favor those. So that if they're separated long enough over millions of years, natural selection working here, favoring certain traits, natural selection working here, favoring other traits, is going to actually create them into two different species. This would be a branch on the evolutionary species tree, such that even if the river dries up one day and they end up living together again, they can have kind of like the horse and the donkey, they can have enough genetic separation that they can't reproduce anymore and they're new species. One example of that is this is a picture of the Grand Canyon. And before the Grand Canyon formed, there was an ancestral species of squirrel that gave rise to these two species. So what happened was before the Grand Canyon was formed, this ancestor species of squirrel lived all in this area here. But when the Colorado River came through here and cut it in half, they couldn't get to cross the river anymore to reproduce. So they were geographically isolated. Natural selection favored certain traits in this population over here, favored other traits in this population over here, even though to our eye they look pretty similar. But scientists have taken these two squirrels, put them in the same conditions in a lab where they live together. They can't reproduce and have babies anymore because they've been isolated long enough that the traits natural selection favored over here has changed the DNA enough that from these guys that they are now considered two different species of squirrel. So to kind of summarize the steps you need to have in your notes, write these down of how do you get two species from one is one, you have to have an ancestral population that's split by a geographical barrier. And write down some examples of geographical barriers. That could be a river. That could be plate tectonics pulling a continent apart and an ocean comes in the middle. It could be a volcanic eruption that lays down a big lava spill that separates, some ant populations from other ant populations. Anything on the earth that causes the geography to change and it causes one population to get split into two is going to be responsible for a branching point where you can get two new species from one. But anyway, so you have to have your original population split. Random mutations happen in both populations on either side of the geographical barrier. They're random, but natural selection, step three, natural selection chooses the best ones for survival in each population. You know, if one area of a mountain range maybe that comes up, another example, if one area is drier, one area is moister, natural selection is going to favor surviving in drier areas on one side, so natural selection favors surviving in moist areas on the other. And the mutations that come up that work for those environments are going to be able to be passed on, and the ones that don't help them survive aren't going to get passed on. And you give that enough time, thousands of years, hundreds of thousands of years, you can get the two populations eventually evolving into one new species. So again, just a couple other examples that you can kind of think of. This not only happens with animals, it can happen with plants. They can be geographically isolated. If you have plate tectonics maybe pulling a continent apart, maybe you have an ocean coming across here, so these plants can't normally breed because maybe this is, you know, 100 miles. So natural selection favors one condition over here versus different conditions over there, so that they evolve into two species. Again, such that if this dries up one day and they can end up being in the same geographical area, they've changed enough that they're considered different species and they can't reproduce with each other. This happened with the two types of porkfish on either side of the Isthmus of Panama. This area here used to be under the ocean, and this was an ancestral population of porkfish that lived over here. The Panama Isthmus came up out of the water, separated them into two species, into two populations. Over time, natural selection favored two different traits, and then you got two different species evolving from that. All the crazy big birds on the Earth are an example of geographical isolation from plate tectonics that did that. There's a bunch of different species of salamander in California that all evolved from an ancestral species. So we got many species evolving from one in different areas as they actually, the ancestral species migrated down from Oregon and got trapped in different places in California. You can read this and kind of see how as certain populations kind of got left in different places as the whole group kind of migrated and filled up California, those populations became isolated in their own little geographical areas and they evolved into different species. And that's it. So if you can even think of when this fish first came out of the water on the land, this is a geographical barrier. You got it. So that's how we get more species from one ancestral species. Thanks for watching. Your next task is to watch a review video and answer some questions on this.